Now, I want to introduce our panelists here. All familiar names to us, and certainly to me. Nancy Poppe, Willis Dallas, wife of Marine, is Senior Vice President, U.S. Marine and North American Practice Leader for Yacht Practice. Nancy also oversees the practice's delivery of quality yacht risk management and insurance broking expertise for North American yacht owners. Before joining Willis, Nancy led the yacht practice as another global broker for 10 years. Nancy earned her BBA from Hofstra, and she'll lead our discussion today, which includes Clive McCartney of Seaman Marine, who was born and raised in Hofstra near England. Clive left school at 18 to join the Royal Navy before attending Cambridge University on a cadet scholarship. And he held management positions at NCL and Carnival, interestingly, before joining Yacht in 2004, where for 13 years he headed up their yacht management teams, including servicing over 60 yachts in worldwide inventory. In September 2018, he established CMAC, Maritime Services, to provide professional services to the maritime industry in South Florida. And one of my favorite characters, Captain Billy Zinser, I made him change it from Bill to Billy on the introductory notes. Bill, of yacht logistics. Bill officially began his professional yachting career in the mid-70s. I know this only too well. Although he would say, they would say that he's been dating all his life. It goes back a very interesting note. I'm only reading excerpts from their bios. So as they're speaking, if you want to dig into it, you'll find it a lot more interesting. Bill's career as a captain was launched in 1978. Spent several years as a captain on various size motor yachts. In 1995, he joined a 43-meter, 142-foot flagship cakewalk, as you know. Then construction of the new 62-meter, 204-foot cakewalk began in March 1998. And in early 2005, the next cakewalk, an 85-meter. That's how you cascade into real estate right there, 280 feet. In the fall of 2016, I have to mention this, Captain Bill Zinser received the International Super Yacht Society Award and distinctions, the Distinguished Crew Awards. We have some really great experts. Bill, bear with me. I have to tell the story, okay? Coming from a career totally outside of yachting, and having been invited to an event in Darien, I stayed on the yacht. This is the very first yacht I ever set foot on, okay? And when I walked on this yacht, and Captain Billy Zinser was the skipper, the yacht called the Jet, I thought I had arrived. I thought I had arrived on this 58-foot pirate. And I thought, wow, this is unbelievable. So, Nancy, why don't you take it from there?
Before I start, I would just like everyone to get a big birthday in the room. So I would like everyone to just kiss their lips and happy birthday.
Please don't take
me. And Bill does not probably remember this, but my very first yacht that I stepped foot on during my career, like day three, was kicking in at the airport. And we have to do a lot of things at home. So thanks very much to everyone for coming today, and we're going to talk about the verdict in the suit of the end of summer in the context of what are called employment practices or employment marine practices. And I apologize if people can't see the screen, I just kind of need to see on that. And yeah. Was that me or you? Okay. So on January 30th, this is the headline. A heinous crime had been committed. The perpetrator went to jail, and the woman who was raped filed a civil suit in Broward County against the vessel owner on the summit. When this headline hit the news, our phone was ringing off the hook. I saw all of our, my colleagues and patron insurance brokers in the room to say the same thing. Everyone wanted to know, if this happened to me, would I have insurance? And the answer is it depends. And we're not here to talk about insurance. We're not going to address that today. In a situation like this, once insurance enters the picture, it means the bad event has already happened. So what we want to talk about today is preventing or at least mitigating the bad events. Bill and I were talking about this. It's a topic we've don't talk about openly in the yacht industry, at least I've never heard it discussed in an open forum in the yacht industry. So, given the nature of yachting, I think it's a really critical and important topic, and that's employment-related practices. So, briefly, briefly, I'll just define or describe what we mean when we say employment-related practices. Harassment can be based on gender, race, age, religion, sexual orientation, disability, or activity. It can be an abusive or hostile work environment, long-term termination, retaliation, and negative hiring. So those are the kinds of labels given to employment-related practices, bad employment-related practices. And examples of behaviors are unwanted sexual advances, threats of violence, offensive jokes or statements, anything that could be considered by an employee to create a hostile or intimidating work environment. And what's important about that is it's subjective in many cases. So what one employee finds to be a very funny joke, another employee might find to be completely inappropriate and create an environment in their work, in their opinion, difficult to work in. And so that's the animal that we're dealing with here. Overall, though, poor employment practices are detrimental to poor employees in companies. And they also create a liability for owners, business owners, and most importantly, vessel owners. So now that I've identified what are considered to be the key bad employment practices or employment practices, we'll tie that back to in this summer. Okay. So these are right from the court documents, right off the Broward County website. And these are factual allegations made by the agreed key vendor. So there was alcohol, the defendant got drunk, he forcefully entered the stateroom, raped and threatened to kill. The captain was the only other person on board. There was a non-functioning phone system, so she was unable to call for help. And there was a great distance between her room and other rooms, the captain's room, so she couldn't be heard. Now, these facts were actually used to establish negligence of the vessel owner. And this is the information the jury heard and considered to deliver their verdict of almost $71 million. So the yacht owner has a duty of care for the safety of employees. Without a working radio and being so far away in proximity, the woman had no ability to be heard, so calling for help. The defendant was unfit for duty. There was unwanted sexual contact, which was actually already duty sacked by virtue of the criminal case. And I should mention that my client is going to speak a little more about the judicial process of this case. So that's another whole interesting discussion. The injured woman also showed in her case that they failed, the boat owner failed to adopt policies and procedures, enforce policies and procedures, such as leave policy, alcohol policy. And you could see easily in this bucket of things that negligent hiring, failure to form background types, it could go on and on. So when you consider what happened on this summer, there is no room for error, there's no margin for error when we talk about these kind of practices and getting out ahead and actively managing them. So does this happen on yachts other than on the summer? Can it happen on yachts other than on the summer? Like Captain Bill, as Bob said, many years running large yachts, very large crew complements, and now as president and co-owner of Yacht Logistics, can it happen, does it happen? Yes. Oh, Thank you. Thank you. I'm getting a little bit of a look out of you.
I think we're going to the end.
Yeah, we're almost. We're getting to the end. Okay. So can it happen over nothing?
Well, you know, my experience is, you know, hiring through is the hardest part of the job. Eventually, Bob will, you know, agree with me. You know, you, like on the last trip, we're up at 29, well, yeah, after a 33 trip, but 29 on board at any given moment in time, sometimes more. And, you know, in the old days, you know, I hate to say the old days, which makes me seem kind of old, but you know, you used to hire somebody who was a friend of yours, or a friend of a friend, or somebody's cousin, or nephew, or, you know, it's kind of a word-of-mouth industry, because you didn't have the internet, and, you know, people, you did the best you could, and, you know, I had really good luck, really helped people like Bob and other industry people, of getting really good team members, but I'm 6 years ago out of them now. You have something like 8 marriages that have come, you know, through the various folks, you know, working together on various folks, take walking, you know, most of it. But, you know, it doesn't always go that way, because sometimes, a deck hand or another crew member will be in love with one of the other girls on board, and she doesn't, you know, she's not feeling the same way. It's happened to us once, and we had the first officer stand at the guy's cabin and watch him pack his stuff and then walk him up to escort him off the boat up to the hotel. And we repatriated him back to the same country the next day. But that type of thing does happen. And, you know, but as far as hiring, you know, now it's not easy because there's so many people that we don't know out there that are working for jobs. So now we have the internet, we have security companies that we can use, background check companies that we can use, and even with all that, you know, it really takes people's gut feelings. You know, when I interview somebody, I have a good or bad feeling about them. And my first officer, he would interview people and I said, "What do you think?" And he'd go, "You know, like that seems a bit shaky," or, "Yeah, he's great, I think." So, you know, a lot of it is gut feeling. Still, even with the internet, the help of the internet, and, you know, then we had other things happen. We had, you know, again, the shipyard. So we used to think the shipyard is the time where you just relax, it's still in the shipyard, you know, you have to choose on vacation, you know. But that's really one of the most sensitive and, you know, times you have to be on guard, because you're sitting in the shipyard, half the time you have doors off, you have plastic over where a door used to be, you have, you know, other people on board every day, subcontractors. Like we ended up having a subcontractor steal four audio-visual iPods that big folk were. Why? Because the sliding glass doors weren't locked. And, you know, we knew the company. We used them many times because we had a new guy that came in from South Africa or someplace and worked for them. And you know, it turned out bad. But one thing we figured out is that we have cameras everywhere in the world. So we were easily able to identify who the guy was and, you know, getting recorded. So, stuff still happens. I mean, I could have easily gone, you know, the way of doing this thing. I could have been, you might have snuck on the boat and, you know, attacked one of the girls at night, you know, knowing what our crew complement was, knowing a lot of people were on vacation, knowing that the boat was having paint work done, it was having mechanical work done, there was people coming and going. So, you know, super doesn't mean time to relax. Super means you have to be aware of everything that's going on. You know, you have to have procedures, you know, again, safety management, you know. And that's it. You let people out. They have to sign in, they have to sign up, they have to wear a tag if they're not a crew member. You have to know who they are, you know. And if a crew member is feeling, you know, nervous about somebody, whether it's a guy or a girl, you know, you have to act on it right away. You change it up. You change up a change the watch schedule because a guest becoming a little too touchy feely with one of the girls. So change the schedule. And the guy kept asking me, "Where is so and so?" Well, she's, you know, we wrote that she's in a different schedule. And, you know, the guest gets angry about it sometimes, but, you know, you have to do stuff like that. It's not easy to hire people that you don't know. So, I guess the bottom line is everyone's got a different style. My style is to hang out with people. You know, I don't just sit up in the tower and expect everyone to do everything. I went to them every day, pretty much. And that's just with them. I hang out with them. I go down in the laundry room, and I hang out with the laundry guy and chat with him. He's a nice guy, really. I can hear it, but, you know, it's kind of, you know, that's the way you get the best feeling for what's happening on board, is to work for the court. You still, you know, you don't have to be friends with them, but you just, you know, pass the pleasantries of everyday life, you know, talk about their families they have, and you know, and you can pick up a vibe pretty quickly. You know, once you get to, you're in the close team with a bunch of people 24/7. You know, after a while, you really get a feeling for what's going on. You can see the interaction between the two members doesn't like the other team. Maybe you can see, you know, if the first mate's being, you know, too hard on people, you can feel that right away, the doctor, and how they, you know, just the blast you see each other after you walk spot. You know, little things you can pick up on, and then you have to have a chat, because you can't just let it go, because it doesn't go away, it just gets worse. So, you know, and in this instance, I mean, I hate to say I would have done this, I would have done that, but, you know, some of these stay on the boat, and there's only one other female on board. I'm even pretty damn sure I know who that guy is, where he came from, you know, and if I'm staying on the boat, you know, everybody says, oh, the captain's on board. Well, I think, you know, in the big take off, I couldn't hear what was going on, you know, at the other end of my deck, let alone what's going on down the street, you know. It's both those soundproof, you know, they're probably to keep sense from traveling around the boat. So, you know, the phone system was out, but the phone system would have been useless anyway. But when he speaks to the radio, not too many people, I mean, usually the radio handle or the radio check is usually too close to the boat, just what they want. You know, they need to have the radio ready. So that might have helped them. Not sure if they didn't do all of it, the radio check radio, or just no telephone system. Yeah. Well, whoever's on watch has to have the radio charged and ready to go and on. Especially if they're the only person on the boat, I'm sorry, but the captain's on board and he's up there. You know, in my opinion, the other person, whether it's not if it's a female, male, engineer, stewardess, their radio should be on and ready in case they need to be called, in case it's fire. Or, you know, like a fire in the block. But I mean, if something happens, you're pushing the radio on all night while we're in bed as well. And that, you know, shows you details how much you have a radio and how much you have. So, you know, the radio is important because we use them all the time. I mean, I forget I even have it on. I mean, it's just on the boat, coming back from Alaska to Seattle. And, you know, it just seems normal for me to just put the radio on my belt. You got to get on the belt. Because if I'm there and I'm working, you know, you need that communication with everybody. Because, you know, the engineers think, you know, what are they going to do? You also need to go, oh, no, no. You know, you can't hear it spin. It's something like all sound system. So I think, a lot of it is, that's part of it. But the other part is, who's this guy? Where did he come from? Did he fill out the forms? Did anybody check on his references? You know, if it wasn't the captain, it was the first officer, engineer, whoever it is. You know, my guys and girls and school, check them out. If you have references, they call them. They get on the internet, they type his name, and they check his Facebook page out. And then they say, you know, I'd ask them, do you feel comfortable with this guy staying on the boat? He's not a normal crew member, what do you think? And they go, yeah, I don't know, it's strange. Sometimes it was nothing, sometimes, you know, I said, okay, fine. He's staying off the boat, and, you know, even if they had to rent him a hotel room, get him off the boat, go stay in a hotel, and then, I come back the next morning and work, you know, and it's hard to have an overall policy, but the basic policy is you let them out first, you make them fill out the forms, everyone checks on them. You know, you can show they do data. We used to do that with data. It's the best we could. You know? But after we got things robbed off the boat, we of course had a different procedure right away. We sat down, went to the office, we wrote a new procedure for work mode. You know, when you're sitting at a dock, you're in a sales room, you know, that's what happened. You know, so like we were sales, but it had nothing to do with that. It had to do with the shutdown process. Yeah. And so that was a new thing, but, that was, we let our guard down a little bit. We had the guy on board several times to do work, never had a tiny bit of problems for 2 years before that. And this one time, we let our guard down. If I saw food on the internet, it's flying back there. So I waited until probably lunchtime when we knew we were eating. And then, grabbed the iPad. But it's pretty easy. It's pretty easy. It's pretty easy. It's
Thank you for that, but I just wanted to Clive, from your experience, one time Susie's MCL, and then, of course, when you were at Crazy Rock and now with Team Up Maritime Services, what kind of experience have you had, and your suggestions for how to manage this?
I don't have very experience with the actual onboard yacht operations, or any military veterans in the room that recognize the role to take part with the next step. To have that cultural will, to be there and powered to identify a discomfort and then do something about it, then you're probably less likely to have this kind of problem. As a yacht manager or a member of the experience, I've seen some terrible things. Terminations for no reason, terminations for good reasons, dream jumping just to get the repatriation from it. I was misbehaving in that and I think, I think about the amended complaint that the victim in this case filed with the court to kick off her civil suit. And there are a number of things that I'm just going to kind of paraphrase. Failure to adopt an alcohol control policy. Failure to determine sobriety and health of the crew before they come aboard. Failure to provide security infrastructure, whether that's security extras, security cameras, and custom Failure to provide training instructions to the roof. Failure to have procedures, rules, and regulations regarding excessive harassment and battery. Failure to perform background checks. Failure in hiring and selecting persons. Doesn't say this kind of complaint, but at least in all of the hundreds of pages that I glanced at the premise that this morning, I would see it. But it didn't say anything about the safety equipment not being on time. But I'm willing to bet that there were questions about the safety equipment and the general maintenance of the vessel. I bet there was oil in the bridges. I bet there was oil in the bridges. My point is that these problems are identifiable in advance. One of the things I saw in the court, one of the court transcripts was, I think it was the plaintiff's attorney said, the owner doesn't have an obligation to provide an accident-free environment. That's impossible. But he does have the obligation to provide an environment where incidents are less likely to happen. And that could be controlling the risk. But he knows the risk and he's dealing with it. And I think the message for sales brokers who are selling boats to clients, insurance people, owners representatives, attorneys, all of these things are knowable in advance. If you have a boat that is poorly maintained, it's pretty good chance that they're not hiring the people. If you know that they're not hiring the people, it's pretty good chance that they're not maintaining the boat properly. And you can do something about that. You can say something. Whether that is, let's get a risk survey done. Let's find a yacht manager to at least put eyes on this. And put some infrastructure in place, whether that's just some simple hiring process. Let's do some background checks. So there is prevention to be had here. I think we still want to see whether that we can buy an insurance policy is going to protect against the $7 million. Very touched on the American Labor Convention and safety measures. Over 500 pounds if you are commercial or so, you apply for that. But that's only 500 pounds. What about the people running around in the transit boat? Those crew members, those guests are just as dead if that boat sinks. Absent a formal order to take them. right in the morning, when you have to put something in, that's what they do. They have to have it. It's open. It doesn't have to be altered by the customer. So, I guess that would be kind of my message in terms of the incident. You know, these environments are knowable and advanced, and the community that is taking care of these clients that treasure their boat so much has an obligation to help identify it and address it. So,
Thank you both. I think, you know, awareness, the communication structure where crews feel comfortable reporting situations that make them uncomfortable, and the top-down buy-in to the environment and the culture.
There's one other thing I want to say. You talk about the good old days of hiring. You hire the people you meet from within your social network. So then we have 20 years of school agencies. Now what is it? People are hiring from their social network. It's just not a social media network. And I have increasingly seen really bad hiring decisions. With a complete absence of culture and procedure. Because they're hiring from Instagram and Facebook. I'm not done following up with the background checks, decent bias testing, reference checks, because the agency is no longer involved. They're doing it within their own social media network. So that's the problem. I'm sure that's the problem.
That's not the problem.
He was going at double speed.
That's what everybody believes in. You know, if you're on the internet, you must be sure.
Well, having social media policies under, that's a question I actually have. How does social media change the dynamic between crew and between guests and...
Now, we have a policy where people are not allowed to put anything on social media pushing their own credit. You see the people who started with it showing up on their Facebook page and going, what are you thinking? You have to let somebody read it.
Anything else before we turn it over to the audience? Okay. Thank you both. Any questions?
Okay, please bring the mic.
The question is what was the vessel's flag?
The vessel's flag is Marshall. I don't think that was a problem because the judge is pretty quick to award those.
As part of risk mitigation, we have our own established placement policies, I think the big issue with this case is the insurance paid out, obviously, but they're trying to pierce this LLC and get the owner for much more than maybe they could have. Are we still advising that our owners put them in the exact same LLCs as before? Are they getting any stronger? Are they ever bulletproof?
I will have to ask the lawyers and the lawyers to respond to that one. Because I agree, we're watching this too. Can these corporate, you know, the LLC they'll be pierced and what, you know, how detrimental that would be to the industry?
Pushing the LLC is not that easy. If the owner has maintained corporate flag, and by that I mean if the bank account is remaining with the corporate entity, all the contracts that you sign are remaining with the corporate entity,
he couldn't report to the file, that kind of thing. It's not such a simple thing to do. But it's a reminder, this is a reminder that we need to instruct parents when the funding comes in to become of a need to expect the preparation to set the game. Interestingly, the census that used to complain identified only the captain puppet manager. It was only the amended complaint where he brought the hotel trainers brought in the Maritime into the company that was the only
one. Yeah, one thing to remember is that the boat itself is a legal entity. And you don't have to sue any of that normal wood, but you don't have to sue anyone other than the vessel, and the vessel is in itself either. Yeah, that's the point. This is down in state court, so you couldn't assume that you could not assume the vessel in the state court, but they could have brought in any amount of the vessel. But in general speaking, that's the vessel. Often with these things, that's stated.
This question is for Nancy. Nancy, as a result of this, are you seeing underwriters do more due diligence on how the boat's being run? Really looking at who is behind the vessel? I'll go a little bit more to we see quite a few bad actors in this industry. I know on Peter's question with the Clive State, we've challenged the Clive State in the past on boat's licenses, directions, and so on. We've seen four documents of compliance, which for those who don't know what that is, you run a management company that's what you need to be certified by the Cloud State to provide IS and services. And it's being reported to the Cloud State, no action taken. So there is very little cheap in this industry if you're going to try to do it right. It would be helpful if the underwriters would back up folks that are trying to do it right by possibly not ensuring the vessel or putting on premiums to protect themselves from the bad actors.
We have just come out of a time in the past couple of years, well, 10 years ago, of the lowest premiums in my 20-plus year history. More and more insurers in the marketplace who want to underwrite boats and yachts. And with that goes away underwriting. So at some point, you just need a vessel name and document who the owner, the beneficial owner is, but they're not on some census list, and become the full coordinator. Now, following several years of poor results in Lloyd's, which drives much of the insurance in the world for boats, several years of poor results, and last year's three hurricanes kind of on top of that, people have left the marketplace for boats and yachts. Rates are now increasing. Underwriters are underwriting again. And so with that goes, who is it? Who's the management company? Who's managing the boat? And there was a time many years ago, if an owner wasn't using a professional manager, some companies wouldn't even quote them. They wouldn't even quote them. Big or small boat, you know, kind of just right out of the gate. If it was their second or third boat, perhaps, but if they're buying a new boat and self-managing, no. But that's gone away, and now I think it's going to come back. Directly to your question, we haven't seen any change in the underwriting, you know, questions or reading for information as a result of this particular claim.
I'd just like to respond to the point about cloud administration of the owner and the responding. There is one case, this is a case of fault documents. It was reported, when I was running case management administration, it was reported to me one particular team member, a business team member, had fault documents that were issued in the entire general management. And so the UK authorities were all very concerned about how it happened. The vessel was in Florida waters, and because of the floating island that determines that the Cayman Islands vessel was coming into restriction, the local authorities were not prepared to go on board to arrest this guy. And so eventually we had an air show, and he won a ticket to come down to the Cayman Islands, which he did, came down. And then he and I had a last chat. Please had a couple of last chat with him. He spent time in jail, and he learned quite a bit about how he was obtaining, and how others were obtaining these documents. He was fined a lot more than the cost of airfare, and he sent us no way. So, we're happy with those reports. There have been response to sort some of these things out, but it's not always easy because of the jurisdiction issues.
So the case is the fact that you really wrap it. Do you have any questions for
me? Naturally, we all understand the situation and the circumstances. But a little bit of a surprising settlement that not was so high. Is there any rationale or reason why that happened that someone could use to protect themselves? And after this particular young lady on the crew, but it seemed really high, so we just thought, like, if there's any insight you could look around.
Is Mike
talking
to you in the room? You're hiding that? Because I would love to throw this one to you.
The short answer is I was actually going to be talking more about the boat end, but answering your question, because you know, I'm talking about maritime lanes, and the second half of this whole case involves the boat. The first half didn't. But having said that, we are very fine defense lawyers, but sometimes these things happen. And they write books, they tell movies about runaway girls or things like that. And they are in the process of appeals and middle of all of those things in order to get it done. And so I don't want to be second-guessing the company. Like I said, they're very fine defense attorneys, but one of my favorite theories, and this case may be the one that's proved it, is there is no more unsympathetic person in a courtroom than a large yacht owner. And having said that, this just smacks of it. And in the follow-up, the initial claim was, I think someone mentioned earlier, I think Bob mentioned earlier, was just a claim against the yacht, the manager, the captain. And I think some lawyer whispered in the plaintiff's lawyer's ears and said, this is a yacht, and it's a crew members, and Jones Act, and seaworthiness, and the law is a lot better for those crew members. And one thing after another, and it must have been. So they're still fighting it. And then the second half, which I was going to mention, has to get back into the boat and what's happening with the boat now. So that's kind of fucked up.
I was saying, I just wanted to point out, Tom, that it's something that they don't include. One of the things that they, remember, this is true, and one of the things they emphasize is that the owner of the vessel, of the vessel and the individual, made no attempt to contact the crewman after the event to ask if he needed help, if he needed counseling, and that kind of thing does not look good in front of the jury. And the other thing is that the captain allegedly, more or less, told her to shake it off. And that kind of callousness is talking about what it would take to pump up the dams of war that are victory.
Thank you. Yes. You can imagine it wasn't a favorable picture in the courtroom on behalf of the vessel owner, so that kind of award to them. Okay.